The intrigue of history is due in large part to the narrative potential of true events that unfold throughout time. Cleopatra's reign, the rise of the Holy Roman Empire, or the rapid expansion of the Mongol Empire are fine examples of how history can provide us with fascinating stories brought together by compelling characters. Yet the stories we are told so often are more ambiguous than we are led to believe. Though history is seen to be a collection of facts woven together to create a timeline of past occurrences, the reality is that the truth is so often lost in translation. What is true and what is myth are often so confused that with time continuing as normal, it becomes increasingly difficult to separate the two. In short, there's a whole lot of bullcrap out there. With that in mind, I'm Wilf What Culture, and here are 10 historical lies you totally fell for. 10. America's victory in 1812. The signing of the Declaration of Independence in 1776 granted American settlers their freedom from the crown, and though domestic disputes would take up much of their time in the late 18th century, it wasn't until 1812 that the country sought war on the global stage. On the other side of the Atlantic, Britain were fighting in the Napoleonic Wars with the French. Tensions remained high with America, however, before the two countries inevitably went to war in 1812. This was the USA's first major conflict as an independent nation, and taking on the British, though they were preoccupied by the French at the same time, was a colossal task. The war lasted 3 years, with a siege on the American capital and an impressive, though futile, victory at New Orleans for the USA, highlighting the war. Many Americans will eagerly have you believe that they secured victory in 1812, yet the truth is the outcome of the war was really a tie. No land exchanged hands, and the imprisonment of sailors was no longer necessary as Napoleon was defeated. Still, walking away from a scrap with Britain in the 1800s is pretty damn impressive, and the events of 1812 sent a powerful message that America was here to stay. 9. Hitler's manhood myth. An essential tool for political power in Nazi Germany was the ability to create propaganda pieces to indoctrinate the German voters towards their authoritarian ideals. Looking back at the gravity of their claims, it's a wonder that it was so effective, as the vast majority are not only completely untrue, but hilariously, obviously over the top. Propaganda was everywhere in 1930s Germany, but despite the Nazis' plentiful use of this political tactic, that doesn't mean that Britain, on the other hand, didn't have her own propaganda going on too. Only hers was a lot more melodic. Singing "Hitler has only got one ball," a decidedly silly tune coined by British troops, fueled the widespread belief that it was actually true. The rest of the lyrics go on to mock other key Nazi officers, and as a result, the general consensus that Hitler's scrotum is lacking some 50% is pretty much common knowledge. To be fair, this myth is a tough one to debunk, and thankfully nobody is around to give convincing evidence. However, the sheer silliness of the claim would be befitting the World War II propaganda pieces. Also, it's not to be believed that Hitler had 4 testicles either, as Stephen Merchant's character in Jojo Rabbit might have you believe. 8. Napoleon's height problem. The military prowess of French Emperor Napoleon Bonaparte was second to none. His lengthy resume of war exploits made him one of the most respected and feared military minds Europe has ever seen, and his impressive list of accomplishments has allowed him the rare honor of being known by his single name, much like Madonna or Beyoncé. Though his storied history as a fierce military tactician may occupy a fraction of conversations about him, there are other characteristics of his that are also ripe for further scrutiny, one of which being his height. The French general supposedly stood at a mere 5 feet 2 inches. This realization, no matter how unrelated to his ability to command, is surely a blemish on his reputation, as the thought of a dumpy man leading scores of tough soldiers into battle is undoubtedly worthy of a chuckle. However, the French measurement of 1 inch at the time was 2.7 centimeters, whereas the more commonly known imperial inch was 2.54 centimeters. In the measurements we know today, this would put him around 5 foot 5 inches, a mere 1 inch from the period's average height for a male. 7. Richard III. History is written by the victors. With the War of the Roses reaching its climax at the Battle of Bosworth Field in the summer of 1485, Henry Tudor overthrew Richard III, ushering in a new age of English leadership. Legend has it Henry found the crown in a bramble bush during the battle. The throne hasn't changed hands on the battlefield in England ever since, and since the Tudor age began, so did the vilification of Yorkist rule. During Elizabeth I's reign, Shakespeare wrote a play depicting the life of Richard III, and it was no surprise that it was deliberately unflattering. After all, it was Elizabeth's grandfather who took the crown for himself by defeating Richard III, so the decision to make the Yorkist monarch as repulsive as possible was undoubtedly a wise one. However, as time moved forward and relative peace would befall England, Shakespeare's interpretation of Richard III became widely recognised. The truth is nothing of the sort, however, and while he was undoubtedly a narcissist, I mean, what king isn't, his rule was, at least by English standards, relatively unspectacular. My Kingdom for a Horse was a lie, although a very cool sounding one, orchestrated by William Shakespeare, as were most of the stories you're led to believe. 6. The Confederate Flag. The American Civil War is by far the bloodiest battle in the relatively short history of the nation. Sometimes referred to as the War of Northern Aggression in Southern states, the rift that was created perhaps originated as far back as 1828, when the Tariff of Abominations was passed. Yet it is the overwhelming consensus by all credible historians that the emancipation of slavery triggered the four-year battle. As the units deployed for war, both sides carried with them their nation's flag, and though we're led to believe that the Confederate flag is the famous cross that can be seen atop the famous General Lee, this was not the official flag of the Confederate States at the time. The actual Confederate flag soldiers recognized as their own was designed by Prussian artist Nicolas Marshall. Dubbed the Stars and Bars, this design was far closer to the Star-Spangled Banner we know today. The cross flag that we all believe to be the official emblem of the Confederacy is actually the battle flag, used from 1863 to the war's conclusion in 1865. 5. WMDs in Iraq. Following the horrific events of September the 11th in 2001, the thirst for retaliation amongst the American people was thoroughly understandable and present in abundance. Saddam Hussein and his government and their alleged links to terrorist organization Al-Qaeda was perhaps reason enough in the eyes of many for their engagement in what would later become known as the War on Terror. But this conflict was largely justified in the eyes of the people on the understanding that Iraq had stockpiled weapons of mass destruction. Engaging in warfare with Iraq was deeply polarizing to the American people, and President Bush's decision to invade the country was naturally met with its fair share of criticism. However, this criticism would increase tenfold after the realization that Iraq, in fact, did not have access to such devastating weaponry. It is still unknown if this was an oversight on the part of American officials or just a made-up excuse for a war that was for more personal reasons. What followed is a long, convoluted affair which has rendered large parts of the Middle East highly dangerous to tourists from the West. The deeply unfortunate events that occurred were once seen by many to be rational, and the belief that Iraq had access to WMDs was a lie, as a society, we all fell for. 4. Henry Ford invented the automobile. Personal automotive transportation seemed like the stuff of dreams when long-distance travel relied solely on horse and cart. So when Henry Ford blessed the world with the automobile in 1908, crowds surely flocked to what is the first ever motor car. Or that would have been the case if Henry Ford's crowning invention was the first car to be invented. Instead, the truth of who was behind the first automobile is far more blurry. The Model T, Ford's magnum opus, was the first automobile readily available to the masses, with its affordable price tag and efficient manufacturing process. But motorized transportation dates back to the late 19th century with the Benz Patent Motor Wagon, created by the company that would later come to be known as Mercedes-Benz. The invention sported a 1-litre single-cylinder engine that produced a whopping 2/3 of a horsepower. Reaching a blistering top speed of 10 miles an hour, the Peyton Motor Wagon is a far cry from the Mercedes Lewis Hamilton races around in each week. But for its immense impact towards pioneering motorized transportation, it is kind of a tragedy for the masses to believe that the Model T was the first ever car. 3. Einstein's mathematical misconception. Albert Einstein's intellectual prowess is known in all corners of the globe. The German-born physicist is hailed as one of the greatest scientific minds the world has ever seen, with his revolutionary theory of relativity underpinning our understanding of gravity and how it occurs. The battle cry of many underachieving school pupils has forever been the belief that Einstein failed his mathematics class, hinting that the study of numbers is not nearly as important as teachers have led them to believe. This is, in fact, a lie. Now, sure, Einstein has been extensively documented as a somewhat troublesome student, struggling to get to grips with reading, writing, and socially interacting, even himself admitting his outcast status as a schoolboy. However, this aside, historians have noted that there was nothing particularly extraordinary about his schooling at all, with the exception of an invested interest in the sciences. His mathematical understanding was certainly on par with the rest of the class, at the very least. Einstein's path towards physics was surely written in the stars, as his brilliance in the subject was plain to see. With maths undeniably being an essential component of many scientific theories, his understanding of numbers was at the very least enough to get by. 2. Jesus's birthday. The birth of baby Jesus is a tale as old as time, or at least as old as 2,020 years ago. The story of a boy destined to become the prophet of the Christian faith that billions across the world would look to as their guide is etched in the minds of everyone who attended a Christian primary school. The story that is perhaps most well known is the Nativity, with a cattle shed in Bethlehem, Israel, serving as the location for his birth. December 25th is the date we celebrate as the formal day of celebration, sharing good tidings and drinks aplenty before watching Grandma fall asleep to songs of praise. However, it was actually in the springtime that Jesus is truly believed to have been born. As noted in Luke 2:1, the reason for Mary and Joseph's travel to Bethlehem was the conducting of a Roman census. And the reality of the time was, the harsh temperatures that were felt in the winter months meant that censuses simply weren't carried out at that time. Christians will, of course, continue to celebrate Jesus' birthday in December, but this is simply not true. 1. Columbus's American adventure. With his venture into the New World, the Italian-born explorer Christopher Columbus etched his name into history as the founder of modern-day America. Columbus set out to discover a new route to India, under the assumption that if he head west, he would inevitably arrive at his location thanks to the realization that the planet was a sphere. He eventually landed after a year-long voyage in what we know today as the Bahamas. And although it's widely believed that he was the first one to locate it, Columbus never actually set foot in North America. Instead, the first known European to set foot in North America was Norse explorer Leif Erikson. Landing in the Canadian island of Newfoundland from his birthplace in Iceland, it was Erikson who was truly the man responsible for discovering North America. That is, of course, if we ignore the indigenous North American peoples who discovered it by being born there. An archaeological site was discovered on the island of Newfoundland in 1960, with historians believing that the settlement dated back some 500 years before Columbus set sail. The continent would remain untouched by European explorers for almost five centuries, and once explorer John Cabot reached Canada in 1497, the slow process of European conquest in the New World was set in motion. And there you have it, folks, 10 historical lies you totally fell for. Feel free to drop this video a like if you enjoyed it, and drop me a follow on Twitter at YouSlyDogU. I'm Will for What Culture, thanks for hanging out, and I'll see you next time.